Hi and welcome to the RA Group Daily Webcast. Every Monday to Thursday at 3:30, we host a daily webcast where our panel of experts discuss a wide range of topics to help you survive and thrive during the lockdown. Tomorrow we have the 12th episode of our Future of Hospitality series with Victoria Marshall, our RA Group Head of People and Culture, who will be discussing mental health in the workplace with Amanda Scott from Compass Group and Laura Rigdon from It's a Playground, and also joined by Rob Bravo from Talking Talent. Today, though, we have a very cool webcast for you. We have Matt from HEJ and Tommy from Diageo giving us Espresso Martini Masterclass. Please do send through your questions. Now over to you, Matt. True Matt style.
Somebody else muted me. I don't normally mute myself, much to everyone's disappointment. So glad you can all join us today. We know it's only Tuesday, but as we've all been discussing, every day is a drinking day in lockdown. And we've been joined today by an awesome mixologist, so Tommy Cole from Diageo. He's going to take us through our paces and show us the exact way to make an espresso martini. He'll be able to talk about all the balancing of flavours and strengths, get the ratios right, and he'll be able to talk with real expert knowledge about the history of the drink and also entice us into tuning in for future sessions where we go through a whole range of cocktails, some including coffee, but everything including alcohol. So over to Tommy.
Cheers, Matt. Thank you so much for having me today. I'm tuning in live from the HEJ Coffee Roastery at Elephant Park at that beautiful little bar area they've got set up around the side. So if you're in and around the area, once we're free of lockdown, it'll be great to have you to come down and enjoy some coffee till cocktails. And as Matt mentioned, we're going to be going through some of the key fundamental principles of what an espresso martini is, delving into a little bit about the balance and the build, some different techniques, as well as a little bit about the history behind this iconic serve. We're going to be using some fantastic products, including our very own Ketel One Vodka, Dutch brand vodka, as well as Mr. Black's coffee liqueur, which you may have seen featured in the Instagram Live a few weeks back when we were speaking with Matt before. And of course, we're going to be using HEJ's delicious coffee blends as well, which we'll be talking about in a bit more detail. So, where do we want to kick off, guys?
Well, where are we going to kick off? I'm not sure who's coming up live. I guess we're going to go straight into the history of the drink. And I think some people didn't tune into the Instagram Live. Shame on you. So if we start off and just talk about where it came from. I mean, everyone thinks we're familiar with the drink, but maybe not everyone knows about the story. And there's probably a few versions of the story. And as Tommy said to us earlier off screen, no one really knows the truth, so it's going to make for great debate and conversation. And I'm sure as you start drinking more of the drinks, the conversation and the debate will carry on into the wee small hours. So back to you, Tommy. Do you want to tell us a little bit about the history of the drink, who invented it, why the person was such a legend, and a little bit about that?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, it is my honour to mention that this particular serve was created by the late Dick Bradsell. Now, sadly, this absolute legend of the London bartending scene passed away just a couple of years ago. But if you were lucky enough to be served by him, more so in his most recent bar, the Pink Chihuahua El Camion, which is one of Soho's finest underground tequila bars, which is still going today, much to his honour. It is indeed Dick Bradsell who we will be talking about here. It was back in the 1980s, 1983, when Dick was actually serving, we'll leave the supermodel in question unnamed, as there are some entities to who it is. Some like to think it was Kate Moss, some say it was Naomi Campbell. We'll leave it up. Well, let's put it this way. The truth went with Dick a couple of years ago, but He was serving a renowned supermodel who came up to him at the bar that he was working in at the time here in London. So it is a London invention, which is fantastic. We can hold on to that one. And she found something that's going to wake her up and PG-13, F her up. He went into his speed rail, he pulled out a quality vodka, a well-known coffee liqueur brand, and some fresh pressed espresso right off the machine on his bar. And he combined the lot with a little bit of sugar syrup just to sweeten it up, shook it down nice and cold, and served it straight up in a martini glass. At the time, he just called it a simple vodka espresso. And Dick, during his sort of peak bartending era, chopped and changed where he worked from time to time. So for a short period, he worked at London's The Pharmacy, where he renamed the cocktail the pharmaceutical stimulant, which I think you'll agree it very much ticks all the boxes in terms of caffeine and booze content. We love that. he later moved into a head bartender role at Match Bar in central London, where he switched the name back to vodka espresso. But like anything that tends to be served in a martini glass, it tends to adopt suffix martini. So, you know, as the popularity grew further down the line, it became more commonplace and more commonly known as the espresso martini. The construct of it is pretty much the same. I would say that more often than not, you might see it served slightly differently, perhaps in a coupe glass like I have here, rather than your traditional straight-edged martini glass.
Tommy, what's the difference between serving in a coupe glass with the flat edges or the more traditional martini shape?
So the martini glass is an iconic piece of design, don't get me wrong. And a lot of, you know, classic martinis, especially that, you know, gin or vodka, ice cold, dry as anything for me, please. You know, with a lemon twist will do me nicely. But that really is where I would sort of draw the line. Most bars have adopted the coupe purely, you know, for the fact that it holds the liquid a lot better. The straight edge martini, I'm sure you'll be aware, even if you're just on your first martini of the night, and it's quite easy to spill. So a lot of...
I always blame my equipment. So yeah, it's good to know.
The coupe. Which is a much better vessel for holding your liquid and sipping all of your cocktail without spilling it down your front.
There you go.
That's a bit about Dick Bradsell, and you know, not to mention he's actually created a number of iconic cocktails through his career. The Russian Spring Punch, Treacle, and the Bramble are just some to name, but a few. So what else would you like to know, my friend?
Well, I'll tell you what I'd like to know is how to make the perfect one. So you've just told me, I was always thinking that I was being shamed if I didn't use the correct glass. And I'll just put that here. Because we've got the coupes in the roastery. And whenever I pick one up to make them when I'm doing a demo, I think I'm being cool and I'm being on point by using this. But thank you for that advice. And I think when it comes from you, I know I can trust it. So I'm now going to adopt the much easier glass to use than this, which looks lovely, but it is a nightmare for spills.
Absolutely. With the cocktail era constantly in evolution, I think it's safe to say that we can happily serve our espresso martini in a coupe. And I definitely recommend those of you watching at home to invest in, you know, a couple of nice coupes to do so as well. Now, when it comes to creating the perfect espresso martini, there are five kind of key fundamentals that I like to rattle off. One of which is quality espresso. You can't make an espresso martini without quality espresso. It's the namesake ingredient, all right? So we're going to be using HEJ Carnival Blend. And perhaps, Matt, you can tell me a little bit more about that and why it's so perfectly suited in terms of its tasting notes and flavor profile.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it is a great coffee and blend to be using in a cocktail like this. We've got four components in there, and the four components are very complementary. So we've got the Brazil and the Colombian, which give us our broad notes, the rich dark chocolate flavours, smooth caramel. We've got the Ethiopian and Sumatran, and they add the spice, if you like, the carnival of the carnival blend. The Ethiopian stewed fruits, and it just gives a little bit more depth of flavour. We use it obviously a lot for espresso and milk-based drinks, and it works really well to cut through the milk and give some flavour and texture through that. And I think it works equally as well when you combine it with vodka and the coffee liqueur. It needs to be able to stand up for itself and not just sink into the background. And I think that the Colombian and the Brazil are great, but the star of the show for me, it's the Ethiopian and the Sumatran, that little bit of spice.
Absolutely. And I think really to just draw on what you were saying there is the tasting notes of milk, chocolate, stewed fruits and caramel are an awesome amalgamation that really makes this particular serve absolutely banging. Now, rule two, I would say, is definitely shake it well. We're going to demonstrate not only a shaken espresso martini, but also, if you're familiar with nitro cold brew, I've got a nitro machine sat next to me here on top of the bar here at the Hay Roastery, which is an absolute excellent way of producing some delicious nitro version style of an espresso martini.
Tommy?
Yes?
Is Caroline here? We've got a question from Nick, who said, where did you start your cocktail career? So before we see you shake your cocktail, we'd like to know where it all began.
Absolutely. So I actually started in the bartending world back over in Sydney, Australia, sort of serving simple pints, pulling pints for the backpackers that would often come through the city. And it was pretty much to help supplement my not only lifestyle, but also going through university, those student fees, you know what I'm talking about. But having fallen in love with the hospitality trade and, you know, conversing with different people day in, day out, and progressing into the cocktail world, and this is, I'm talking early sort of 2008, 2009, I then, you know, really got into the cocktail scene and worked at some of the top cocktail bars in and around Sydney at the time, which you can believe before 2010 wasn't actually that big a cocktail scene. And that is why London really drew me over to the UK to start working in the cocktail bar scene over here, as it was much, much more developed and continued to grow, you know, from 2010 till now, and is regarded as one of the best cocktail city hubs in the world. And I wouldn't have it any other way. It's absolutely brilliant. So my longest standing term was with CG Bars and Restaurants Dirty Martini Group. You might be familiar with them. And they have a number of cocktail bars throughout the central CBD, as well as the West End, and a few sites sort of remotely outside of London. You know, great company to work for. I helped develop the cocktail program and the training and the menu there. And then a couple of years ago, I decided to become a day walker, is what we kind of call ourselves in the industry. I came out working evenings and started working with Diageo, who is a representative of some amazing spirits and other cocktail and alcoholic beverage brands. And I've been happily working with them ever since. I get to work with amazing people like HEJ Coffee London and the RAG Group. So here we are.
Nice. Awesome. Okay, so are there any other questions coming through, guys?
We do have some, but the only other one I can see here is around the coffee liqueur. What's another favourite coffee liqueur of yours? I think you mentioned Mr. Black's earlier.
So as we're kind of going through the basic constructs, so shaking it really well, I've got a couple of examples of cocktail tools here. So this is a tin-on-tin shaker. This is the Corico brand, which are absolutely brilliant and solid. You can find those anywhere for a very reasonable price online. Otherwise, you've got the more traditional three-piece Parisian shaker, which you can see here, which, you know, is great. It does the job, but I prefer the kind of new school method of the tin-on-tin. So you would build your cocktail in your cocktail tin, add plenty of ice, and then you shake it to hell. Now, the reason we do that with the espresso martini is because within your quality espresso, the natural oils that have been pulled from the coffee itself actually form that beautiful crema on the top. So when you're shaking it, you want to be not only incorporating all the drink, all the liquid ingredients together, you bring it down to temperature with the ice, you're elongating with dilution, as well as ensuring that you're aerating all of those beautiful ingredients there to give you a lovely crema on the top. So shaking, really important. Rule number three is sugar. Be flexible on sugar. And that's where my sort of comment on which coffee liqueur you use really drops in. So I absolutely adore Mr. Black's coffee liqueur. Now, I can give you a good few reasons why. It's 100% natural Arabica bean. It's also fortified with 100% Australian neutral wheat spirit. And it's got about 50% less sugar content than most of the other kind of standard old world, if you will, coffee liqueurs. You know, I'm not one to name and shame, and that's not what we're all about. There are some great coffee liqueurs out there, you know, Kahlua, Tia Maria, to name but two. They're the most common ones that you find in supermarkets, which, you know, will do the job. But because they have quite a high sugar content, you wouldn't necessarily need to add any into your coffee, your espresso martini mix before shaking. Whereas Mr. Black's, because it proudly boasts 50% less added sugar in the bottle, you can add your choice of sweetener to your overall espresso martini mix. Now, I've got a few in front of me here. I've got an all-natural liquid honey. We've got 100% organic agave, which is a really great alternative. Otherwise, I've also got a couple of homemade syrups. I've got a 2-to-1 caster sugar simple syrup, or a rich simple syrup. And I've also got a 2-to-1 demerara simple syrup. So that's made with brown sugar rather than white. So if you're just looking to get a little hit of sweetness, just go for your simple, a 2-to-1 caster sugar to hot water, bottle it down and let it cool. That'll keep for at least a week. Otherwise, a 2-to-1 demerara and those lovely brown sugar caramelized notes really complement the coffee that you're using. So I'd recommend that. Otherwise, yeah, agave and honey are a really interesting alternative. Aside from that, there are some excellent different brands of flavored syrups you can buy. For example, the Monin range, they've got salted caramel, they've got a hazelnut, whatever you're looking for. Is there another question?
Yes.
Tommy, yeah, it's just Caroline again. So I'm type 1 diabetic, and if I was out in a bar, could I ask for a completely sugar-free espresso martini? And would it taste okay? Is the main question.
When it comes to that, sadly, it is a bit of a tricky one. In the sort of world of cocktails, there's always, you know, development. There are some fantastic alternatives to alcohol-free spirits out there now. And certainly when it comes to sugar-free alternatives, you know, people are definitely breaking the mold to enable these to come into the bar scene and open up cocktails to a wider audience. You know, you might be hard done by to find a bar that serves, you know, sativa or, you know, a sugar-free alternative to actual sweeteners. Otherwise, you can ask for it without. The problem is most coffee liqueurs will carry sugar, but if you're okay and you've got your insulin pack with you, definitely go with the Mr. Black's. 50% less sugar than most common retail products, so you should be a lot on the safer side. Yeah, and if you like your coffee flavor strong and, you know, highly bolstered, yeah, go for that.
Perfect, thank you. Good top tip.
Tommy, just before we start shaking, I always have an issue before I got the right equipment, actually. And I was lucky enough to steal your stuff when we did the last demo. So thank you for this. So these are the shakers you were talking about.
Yeah.
And you're absolutely right. They are beautiful to use. Absolutely fantastic. And I love the fact that when they're on there, I can knock it off and feel like a pro. What's the secret for taking apart the three-piece? Because we would do demos, we'd be doing espresso martinis, and get to the exciting bit, you're just about to pour and you can't get the top off.
Yeah, so that's where the three-piece, as I kind of, you probably noticed I hesitated on the three-piece when I brought it out. it does tend to create quite a tight vacuum seal when shaking. So you can imagine, especially when you're producing your hot fresh espresso off the press for your espresso martini, do allow it to cool wherever possible. If anything, like I've done here, pre-batch it and have it ready bottled in a flip top, and even better, have it chilling, ready to go, because you can imagine when you add hot fresh espresso to ice and then put it under pressure in a vacuum and shake it wild, then what's going to happen? It's either going to create quite a solid vacuum that you, to the point where you can't open it, or it's going to explode all over you and your guests as the pressure builds up. And that has happened far too many times out in the real world. So do be careful of that one. Now, when it comes to the three piece, for that reason, is great because it's classic. Maybe for the sort of gentle, you know, snazzy, sexy looking shapes like so, it's all well and good. But, you know, for practicality and to be able to open it safely without any explosions or spillages, the trick really is when you come to sealing it, you want the steel to touch down one side here, almost like a banana shape, and just give it a gentle tap just to create that vacuum seal. And you know, even with ingredients in it, you should safely be able to lift it like so, and it's not going to go anywhere. All right? Then you would shake as normal. Da 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 da. I'll make my own sound effects. And then when it comes to opening it, you're looking for where it just tapers off to a close, and you're going to just hit the larger tin with the ball of your palm. Okay, and that will just simply break the seal, the vacuum seal. So it just pops off like so, and you're an absolute pro. Easily done, or maybe easily said rather than done.
I was going to say easily said, but we've got one. So if anyone wants the comedy value, I'll be making a mess of my kitchen in a few minutes, I suppose.
Cool. So, you know, that really, so when we're talking about sugar content and our coffee liqueur, those are sort of key fact number three. Number four, you need a quality vodka to stand up to that delicious espresso coffee that you're using. So as I mentioned, we're going to be using Ketel One vodka. So I personally come from the wonderful world of Diageo, and this is our premium vodka. Definitely recommend it. It's from the Nole family based in Schiedam in southwest Amsterdam, just outside Amsterdam in the Netherlands. And these guys have been doing spirits since 1681. So they've been doing it for hundreds of years, and they're very, very well adept at it. It's all copper pot stilled. It's got an amazing, bright, citrusy finish. It's so smooth, and it's the perfect ingredient to go into our espresso martini. All right, so good quality vodka is definitely key here. And then finally, presentation. So when we're serving it, we already talked about glassware. The coupe is the kind of the way to go. You want to make sure you shake it well to get that crema, because you're tasting with your eyes, guys. You taste with your eyes before you do take that first sip. It needs to look gorgeous. And you also want that lovely, rich coffee aroma coming off to your nose. So we garnish it with three coffee beans on the crema as well. Why three? Not only is it visually aesthetic, but also they stand for wealth, health, and prosperity. So there's a little bit of a story behind that as well. So without much further ado, Matt, should we make an espresso martini? I think we should, unless there's any more questions coming through.
Fantastic. Now, seamlessly and without anybody knowing, I muted myself, I've used my grinder, I've pulled a shot of coffee, and I've got it cooling down, because I didn't want, as much as you did think the comedy value would be worth it, I didn't want that exploding onto my ceiling and me having to repaint the kitchen, or looking like an idiot not being able to get the top off with a vacuum seal. So hopefully this cools down enough, but yeah, let's go. So you talk me through the steps, I'll be your worst student.
Hopefully you can all see my cocktail can. Fantastic. So like I said, we're going to be building our cocktail in our two-piece tin-on-tin Konica shakers. Now, you typically build your cocktail in the shorter half. So I'm going to place that just in front of me for now. Okay. Now, when it comes to the ratios of a good espresso martini, in terms of vodka versus coffee liqueur, I tend to go a 2-to-1. So 40 mil of our base spirit, Ketel One Vodka. So I've got this little bar tool here, known as a jigger, or a spirits measure. Standard large size is 50 mil, a standard double, and the smaller side, 25 mil, a standard single. So I'm going to pour 40 mil of our delicious Ketel One Vodka that you can see there. And we're going to pour that into our cocktail tin. Voila. Next ingredient, our supporter, is Mr. Black's coffee. Definitely recommend picking up this bad boy. Like I say, 100% Arabica bean, 100% Australian winter wheat spirit. It sits at 25% ABV, so it's a little bit punchier than your usual coffee liqueur, but for good reason. Okay, so we're going to add 20 mil of our Mr. Black's coffee liqueur.
Now, Tommy.
Yes.
Just to ask, when we're brewing coffee and we're doing AeroPress, V60, different brew methods like that, the weights and measures are really important. Obviously, ratio is the overriding thing that we're trying to get right, but we've got certain size vessels and cups and brew equipment that we use. Is it always acceptable to use a barman's pour, or are we going to blow out the flavours and the actual essence of the recipe? And should we be as technical and geeky on getting the mills just right, or is that something that you're going to say, it's like cooking, you know, throw it into taste and it's up to the individual?
That's a really good question. When it comes to ratios, yes, you need to be responsible in terms of the amount of alcohol that's going in. Absolutely important. You don't want the base spirits to overpower your other flavors. But if, for example, you want it a bit sweeter on the sweeter side, or a bit drier, so less sugar, then you can chop and change the recipe ever so slightly. But this is the kind of recommended ratios and measurements. So it's 2-1 when it comes to your spirit and the coffee liqueur, the legs behind that. If you're using, say, Kahlua or Tea Maria or one of the other well-known coffee liqueurs, because of that additional sugar, if you want it a bit sweeter, you know, add a little bit more of that, and you can maybe pare down the amount of vodka you use to balance out that if you're worried about the alcohol content. Otherwise, you know, it's your cup of tea, you have it the way you like it.
Nice.
Guys, just a quick interlude for all of you at home that are hopefully making or following Tommy's instructions and making your own cocktails. If you take a picture of it and pop it on any of the hashtag links that you can see on your screens, the best attempt at home will win a very nice tote bag. I don't know if you've got it there, Tommy, that you can show us, please.
So it's time for what's in Tommy's tote.
Well,
guys can take some fantastic pictures of your espresso martinis that you make at home. Post it to social media platforms at Ketel One, at @hey_coffee, and at @ra_foodUK. And if you can hashtag Locktails Live, hashtag Hey Coffee, and hashtag Espresso Martini, and you can choose to follow me as well, we will be judging the best photos for your chance to win this beautiful Ketel One branded tote bag. And it's not just the bag, there are some goodies inside. I have a beautiful chrome plated Ketel One cocktail shaker, cocktail spoon and strainer, as well as a little sample of the Ketel One vodka. What else have we got? Well, I won't give away too much, but that
is... I'll tell you what, Tommy, what we will throw in there, we'll throw a couple of bags of Carnival in so that they know that they've got quality espresso in the drink as well. So that's something we'll throw in for it as a prize.
You say we, Matt, but I reckon you're going to put your picture in and try and win it. It wouldn't surprise me.
Photoshop first, I think, but yeah. Yes. Maybe.
Brilliant. So where were we? So we had our coffee liqueur, as well as our Ketel One vodka. Now, Matt, what's your sort of preferred choice of sweetener? As I say, I've got agave, I've got the simple syrup or demerara syrup or even honey here today.
Well, I mean, it's a great time to share a really embarrassing story. And I'm quite a simple guy. I come from New Zealand. It's a very small country. You know, we're not as sophisticated as people might think we are. And I've been making espresso martinis and enjoying them for a while. And I've just picked up that we used a sugar syrup. And I was, this is absolutely ridiculous. I was in a bar and I saw simple syrup and I said, oh, that's the same as our recipe, but what's the simple syrup? And he said, it's just sugar. Oh, right, yeah, that's what we use. So I'd always just used a simple syrup, but I'd never really had a formula to make it. So it was hit and miss in terms of the sweetness. And since we talked to you and we'd started collaborating, the agave for me is just fantastic. I love the flavor. I love the little twist of the flavor that it adds to the drink. And it works really well when we're doing the nitro martinis, which you're going to probably touch on later. But for me, it's just the a slightly different flavor of sweetness in here. And I quite enjoy that in the drink. So since I've started using this, I haven't looked back. It's the one for me. Mind you, some of the sugar combinations you were talking about looked pretty special as well. So I might give them a go.
Brilliant. All right, so we're going with the agave today, right?
Agave, yes, please.
Cool. Yeah, absolutely. I love agave. It is, of course, the raw ingredient to our delightful tequila as well. If you love your tequila Tuesdays, agave is the origin story behind that. So we're going to add, I would say, start off with about 5 mil of your choice of sweetener, which is about a teaspoon. But if you've got a sweeter tooth, you can go up in increments of 5 mil or so. So anywhere between 5, 10 or even 15 mil of your sweetener choice, depending on how sweet you like it. Now, I like mine quite dry. I like to taste that coffee, that kick. So I'm just going to put about a bar spoon's worth in. All right. Now, the final ingredient is obviously our coffee. So like I said, we're going to be using the HEJ Carnival blend. And we're going to go with 25 mil of this pre-batched espresso that I have here. In she goes. Righto, so that's all of our liquid ingredients in there. So that was the fun part, Matt. Hopefully it's not messy.
How many cubes of ice do you use? I always thought of 6 cubes, and I always shake it until they're all smashed up and gone. Sometimes when we're doing demos, we do a head-to-head espresso martini event, which is really fun. It's like Saturday Kitchen Live with the Omelette Challenge, and we have a whiteboard and a stopwatch. But the thing that we found is people cheat by trying to shake less. And you mentioned that shaking is probably the most critical part, apart from having the great ingredients. But it's the thing that brings them all together and emulsifies and gets the head and all of the crema, you know, frothy. So we actually put a timer on and we made people have to shake for 30 seconds to stop this cheating. But is there any recommendation in, firstly, cubes of ice or time, or is it just a very vigorous shake that you want us to use?
We shake anything, any cocktail is best served ice cold. So we want to make sure that not only our drink is to be shaken down to the correct temperature, but in an ice cold glass. So if you take your cocktail coupe and you just add ice to your glass, and you could go one step further and just add a little bit of water if you wanted to, through the magic of thermodynamics, help cool your cocktail glass down a bit quicker. But yeah, cocktail glass build is a vital one. When it comes to shaking your cocktail, you limit yourself with the number of ice cubes that you're adding. So if anything, I would say 6 is underdoing it. I would fill the small half, so the small half of your tin-on-tin shaker, right to the top. Don't be afraid to fill it up. So more ice. So ice keep ice cold.
It's an amazing tip and something that I've never had mentioned to me, and I've never actually thought of doing. I thought that I might be diluting the drink and maybe ruining the flavor.
It's a common misconception. So when you go to, I'm sure everyone's had a really poor gin and tonic or vodka soda or whiskey and coke out and about before, where they've just chucked in 2 or 3 ice cubes and it's just floating around the top. It melts almost instantaneously and you're just left with a really flat, warm, lukewarm serve. It's not enjoyable. So actually, more ice is better, is key here. Ice keeps ice cold, all right? So we don't want it to over dilute. We want full control of the dilution. So add as much as you can possibly fit. As you can see here, my tonic shaker up the top.
Right. Okay, do you want to click over to my screen?
Yeah, I see what you're doing. Fantastic.
everyone else can take my, oh, there we go. Look, I've got ice right to the top. It's the first time I've done this, so I'm quite nervous about shaking it now for some reason, but Tommy's the master, so I'm going to go with it.
Now, I'm just going to switch camera so you can just see a bit closer, perhaps. So this is the trick when you're just sort of closing off the conical shaker here. So you put the larger tin over the top of your smaller tin, but at an angle so that the steel touches on one side. Just give it a nice little tap on the top to create that vacuum seal. And then, as you can see, it is not going anywhere.
Okay. One sec, Tommy. Switch cameras back here.
Magic. With the snap of my fingers, and he's there.
Just like that. It's one of those nervous moments.
Whoa!
Look at that.
Well done, well done.
Thank you, Tommy.
True test to make sure that it's properly sealed. So when you're shaking, have the smaller half of the tin towards your body. Now, this is purely a safety thing. So if it does happen to pop open, the contents is going to go over you and not your mate, not your customer. Yeah? So keep it facing towards yourself. Hold both the top end of the shaker nice and firmly, as well as the bottom half. And we're going to give it some welly, guys. Now, if you choose to make eye contact with the person you're serving while shaking, that's down to you. If you're looking to pick up, you know, Matt and I will, you know, digitally stare into each other's eyes as we shake this cocktail.
Tommy, quick question. Have you got a favourite song that when you're shaking, it's a good rhythm to do it to?
That's a really good point. Let me think. I don't know. Maybe like the pizza. That might be a little overkill, but I know that was just to try and ensure that everyone was shaking it, you know, for an even amount of time to be, you know, fair in the results. But I would say anywhere sort of between 10, 12 seconds should do the trick, just making sure that everything's whipped up really nicely. Now, to open your tin without making a mess, like I say, look for that taper where the tin is just coming off to a close where the steel touches, and then supporting both halves with your strong hand. All right, we're just going to use the ball of our palm and just tap the large tin, and it should just release the vacuum seal and pop right open. Now, already, again, if I just quickly switch camera, you can see the beautiful crema developed inside there. That's exactly what we want to see. How are you looking, Matt? He's on mute.
They muted for my shaking, and that was my best line and best joke ever. I'm not going to repeat it, but cocktail is looking good.
Fantastic. So we're just going to discard the ice that we were using to chill our glass. Our glass is nice and cold. Now we've got a couple of other geeky bits of bartender kit. We have a single strainer, the one in my left hand here, otherwise known as a Hawthorne strainer. Or four-prong strainer, several names, and then we have a fine strainer. Now, we use a fine strainer to catch any of the fine ice crystals or any more ingredients that we might possibly have in our cocktail, because we don't want them floating around in our serve. We want a nice, smooth consistency throughout as we drink. So we're going to pour, having placed the single strainer on the top of our large conic cocktail tin, we're going to pour the content through our fine strainer into our glass. And make sure you get all of the liquid out and give it a little encouragement, a little tap, because you want the lovely crema to come through and not just stick inside of your tin to the ice. All right? Now look at that. We'll switch cameras to get a closer look at it in a moment, but that is looking beautiful. How about you, Matt?
Yeah, the crema is so good, it's not going through my fine strainer. So that's a good sign.
So that's the fresh press espresso talking there. It's got all those lovely oils that have been extracted out of the coffee, and that's what really creates that beautiful crema. So you can see there, Oh, yes. So you've got the beautiful divide, the jet black coffee there, and that lovely white frosty creamer on the top. Now, the final stage, like I say, rule number five is presentation. So we want to make sure that we've got three coffee beans in the center in a star or flower formation. And as I mentioned, they stand for wealth, health, and prosperity. Fantastic. So let me look down.
Awesome.
Okay, I'm just going to tilt my screen down.
Oh, yes, look at that.
Good job. Oh. Well done, Matt.
Yeah.
Guys, that looks awesome. We have run out of time for today, okay. But like, Tommy, thank you so much. Cheers. Yeah, cheers to you two, because you have a great drink in your hand. We'll just have to go and make our own, girls. Thank you so much today.
Literally, I've made hundreds, maybe not thousands of these. Tommy, this is the best one I've ever made and ever drunk. Thank you.
That's a statement.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you so much for today, guys. Just wanted to reach out to everyone and hope that some of you can join us on the Calm quiz later. Meanwhile, for more information about our programme of discussions, please go to RA Group's website at www.ragroup.co.uk/news to download the broadcast links. Meanwhile, if you've got any questions or suggestions about how you can get involved, email gavin.goody@ragroup.co.uk. Thanks for joining us and have a great afternoon. Bye, guys.